The title of my message this morning is God, Why Me? So last week, my message was titled A Roadmap to the Promised Land, and I talked about being in the wilderness and that God's purpose was to bring the children of Israel into the wilderness so that they could worship Him. And I feel like I kind of glossed over the fact that God wants to create an atmosphere where we will worship Him, where we'll get close to Him. And so this week's message is really going to be an extension of last week's message. If I was going to do anything, I would name this part two. But we're going to start off in the book of Revelations, chapter 12, verse 11. And it says, "And they overcame Him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they did not love their lives to the death." And we can apply this concept to our lives. This is talking about end times in Revelation, about events in Revelation where they overcame the evil one and the dragon at that time that it mentions in the book of Revelation chapter 12, that they were able to overcome him. If you read in the Amplified Bible, Revelations 12:11 in the Amplified, same passage of scripture, it says, "And they overcame and conquered him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony, for they did not love their life and renounced their faith even when faced with death." And so I wanted to include that because it says they did not renounce their faith even when faced with death. And if we apply that same passage of scriptures, that they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And so what was their testimony? Their testimony was that Jesus Christ died, forgave their sins, and rose again and lived. And our testimony should be the same, that Jesus Christ died, He rose again for the forgiveness of our sins. And because He lives, we can live. That should be the same testimony, church. We should be able to overcome because of the blood of the Lamb and the words of our testimony. Amen? We should be able to overcome. But so many times you see defeated Christians that have gone through troubles, have gone through the wilderness, and they say, "God, why me? God, why am I going through this?" And so what happens so many times, and I've seen it and I've done it, I've experienced it, that people get in the wilderness and they get defeated and they shrink back. They say, "God, why me?" And then all of a sudden, they don't want to go to church anymore. And I'm not saying you have to go to church to be a Christian. But it is easier to be a Christian when you're in a body of believers. Amen. And that's why God says, do not forsake gathering with believers. I understand what it's like to shrink back from believers. I understand what it's like to not want to be in church. I fully and completely understand that. But I also understand that God wants to take us through the wilderness to bring us closer to Him. And the second part of that, "For they did not love their life and renounce their faith even when faced with death." If we can apply that principle also to our lives. God, I know that I'm going through a hard time, but I'm not going to renounce my faith. I'm not going to give up my testimony of who you are and what you can do just because I'm going through the wilderness. Amen? Has anybody in this place ever been in the wilderness? Is anybody in this place in the wilderness? I gave you the roadmap to the promised land last week, and this is a component of it. Encouragement, church, this is encouragement to persevere and push through. We read verse 11, but we're going to read verse 10, just before verse 11. And we're going to read this out of the Amplified Bible. It says, then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power and the kingdom, the dominion and reign of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser of our believing brothers and sisters has been thrown down at last. He who accuses them and keeps bringing charges of sinful behavior against them before our God day and night. And we read that passage of scripture, and then we read the following passage of scripture that says that they overcame. So you get into that place of the wilderness, and Satan comes against you. And probably what the first thing is he's going to tell you is like, what are you doing? You're going through a hard time. I don't think God even loves you. Are you even really saved? Has anybody ever had that question come to their mind? Let me tell you something. That is the voice of the enemy coming against you. And the Bible says that they overcame those thoughts, those intrusive thoughts, those behaviors, all those things that go along with it, and the seriousness of the fact that the devil is trying to draw you out of God's presence, whether you're in the wilderness or not. He's trying to draw you out of God's presence and convince you that you don't even know who God is. You can't serve him. The troubles and the tribulations that you're going through is God's judgment on you. Has anybody ever thought that? God, if I was going through this and I can't even hear your voice, it's because your judgment has come upon me. Has anybody ever felt that way? We're going to go to the New Testament, obviously, John chapter 15, verse 18 through 20. And this is a picture of the fact that Jesus went through trials and tribulations on this earth. Amen? Amen. Jesus was not received in his hometown because they said, oh, you're just that carpenter guy's son. You can't be the Christ. And they shunned him and pushed him away. We don't want to hear what you have to say. The purpose of Jesus was to come tell a story of love and compassion and salvation. And his hometown said, we don't want to hear it. We don't want anything to do with you. And then he was persecuted up to the point of his death. And so the thought of what Jesus went through, the persecution that he suffered, and then he says this in John 15, verse 18 through 20. Says, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, the world would love its own. If you were not going through, if your life was perfect, and no troubles ever happened, and this world treated you with love and compassion continually. And listen, I'm not saying that you can't make decisions into your life that will make your life easier. I think that we should use and apply wisdom in our lives so that we don't have the troubles and the trials of hardships that sometimes we go through, right? So if I've got a herd of cows that are going to end up having babies, and they're going to create a crop of baby cows, and a lot of you that are farmers and ranchers understand this concept, that you have cows. If I go out and slaughter all my cows because I want to put meat in the freezer, I'm essentially doing myself harm because those cows are going to have babies, and they're going to create an income for me. That would be a foolish decision to do those things, right? It might look good on the surface. Hey, I'm going to put up a lot of meat. So we need to use wisdom in the hopes and godly wisdom that further down the line, we're not going to fall into traps and snares because we have used that godly wisdom. Does that make sense to everyone? If you were of the world would love its own. Yet because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. If Jesus went through trials and tribulations, you know what, church? Jesus was tempted in the desert by Satan when he was at his weakest. How can we believe that those kind of things would not happen to us also? If they happen to Jesus, they're going to happen to us. If we go through trials and tribulation, it's for the glory of God. And so I wrote this in my notes. Many people believe that the fact that they are going through a trial or tribulation, aka the wilderness, that is God bringing judgment and wrath upon them. If I'm going through troubled times and hard times, that's because God's pouring out judgment on me. And that is not truth at all. Now, some things that we go through, like I said before, is the result of our own decisions. Sometimes we cannot escape the consequences of sin. And many times Christians cry out, God, please deliver me from this. But they're living in the consequences of their own sin or their own bad decisions. And I have been there. I don't know if anybody else has ever made a bad decision before. I remember, and I've told this story, I remember I got my first credit card, and it was for like $1,000. And I thought, man, I've got money. No, it turns out I didn't have money. I had credit. There's a difference. I had credit, but I thought I had free money. And so what did I do? I went to Best Buy, and this was when DVD players first came out. Man, I wanted a DVD player. And I bought a DVD player. You can buy a DVD player for like $30 now. I paid $500 for a DVD player. And I bought all the DVDs that would go up to $1,000. And so I maxed out. This is a completely true story. I maxed out a $1,000 credit card in about 15 minutes. I'll take this DVD, this. As a matter of fact, my wife was clean. You know, I can't remember the last time I watched a DVD. I think people still do that. We were cleaning out our house the other day, and my wife said, do you see how many DVDs we have? That's a true story, too. She said, look at all the DVDs we have. I was like, yeah, I know. Credit will buy you lots of DVDs. But I could not escape the consequences of my sin, and that was sin. I had fleshly desires. I wanted stuff. I bought stuff, and guess what? They want to get paid back. And if you don't get paid back, guess what? Your credit goes bad. Sometimes when you make poor decisions, you cannot escape the consequences of those poor decisions. That doesn't mean God can't intervene and move, but as far as I know, God didn't call up the creditors and say, hey, I got it covered. He said, no, Clay, you're going to have to deal with consequences of your sin and your actions. So we can have the consequences of sin that can disrupt our life and take us through the valley, the wilderness, the trial, the tribulation, or we can have life itself just happen around us and we can go through the trials and tribulations. Sometimes it's not self-inflicted. Sometimes it just lurches up upon you. I know that there's people that have experienced that also, right? That life has just showed up at your door and all of a sudden you have to deal with the trials and the tribulations that are the attack from the enemy. But the Bible is clear about the purpose of the wilderness. And so for us to say, God, where are you? God, why me? God, and let me be clear, God does not bring hardships on us for the sake of bringing hardships on us. Sometimes he allows things to happen to us, but we also have to differentiate that between an attack of the enemy. Because the Bible says that Satan is prowling around like a lion trying to devour us and our families and all of our things. So there is a difference, but the Bible is clear about the purpose of the wilderness. We're going to go to Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. And I've preached on this before, but we need to grab a hold of it and realize it with the intention of saying, God is for me, not against me. And sometimes things happen on our life and we can still benefit from those things. But you say, no, I'm supposed to be over here in the promised land. I'm not supposed to be in the wilderness. But what is the purpose of the wilderness? Therefore, verse 1, Romans 5. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And we read that statement and we should be able to apply that in any situation in our life. Promised land, wilderness. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into his grace in which we stand. And rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations. Hardships come my way and I'm supposed to rejoice? That's ridiculous. God doesn't want me to suffer. I've told you my testimony about when God delivered me from sin. And God showed me how he was going to reveal my sin to my family so I could end up being delivered. And I made the statement, God, you wouldn't expose my sin because you love me too much. How arrogant is that to believe that God would not use anything and everything to try to deliver me from something? And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation, and listen, this is what God wants to teach you when you're in the wilderness. If you've ever asked yourself, God, why are you doing this to me? Here's your answer. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now, hope does not disappoint. You will not be disappointed at the end result. And I can't tell you how many times I've heard Christians that have gone through the wilderness and they've grumbled in the wilderness and they said, God, why are you doing this to me? But then when they get to the other side, they cry out and say, God, now I see what you did. Now I see your purpose. Now I see that you were up to something. Well, what a miracle. God, you did have a purpose in that. I can't believe it. Why is that? Now, hope does not disappoint. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. If you will listen to the Holy Spirit and you will analyze the situations that you're in, you will be able to look at your wilderness and say, God, what are you trying to teach me in this moment? What are you bringing me through? If you can do that, it'll be a lot easier to get to the promised land because you won't have to wait on God as much to teach you that lesson. Amen. You ever seen somebody that had no clue and they're like, well, I don't know why this is happening. And somebody from the outside can look at it and say, well, God's trying to teach you this. But it has to become real to the believer. And so if you're in tune with the Holy Spirit, it makes that process much, much easier. I'm going to read the same passage of scriptures out of Romans chapter 5, verse 1 through 5, but I'm going to read it out of the Amplified Bible. And I study mainly with the New King James Version, but I often read in two or three other versions to get some perspective and make sure that there's nothing that I've missed. So this is out of the Amplified Bible. It says, therefore, since we have been justified, that is, acquitted of sin and declared blameless before God by faith, let us grasp the fact that we have peace with God and the joy of reconciliation with Him. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed. Through Him, we also have access by faith into this remarkable state of grace in which we firmly and safely and securely stand. Let us rejoice in our hope and the confident assurance of experiencing and enjoying the glory of our great God, the manifestation of His excellence and power. And not only this, but with joy, let us exult in our sufferings and rejoice in our hardships, knowing, and listen to this, this is also what the wilderness produces in us. Let us exult in our sufferings and rejoice in our hardships, knowing that hardship, distress, pressure, trouble produces patient endurance. Amen. Patient endurance. And if you've spent any time with me, you realize that I'm not a very patient person. Thank God I'm not where I used to be, because I used to be so impatient. You know, I'm the person that gets mad at the microwave. I'm the person that gets mad at McDonald's. I'm the person that gets mad at Chick-fil-A, because none of that is fast enough for me. This next one is going to be a tough pill to swallow. It produces patient endurance, and endurance, proven character, spiritual maturity. You know why you're saying, God, why me? Somebody else want to say it besides me? Why are we saying, God, why me? A lack of spiritual maturity. And I'm not immune from it, because I have said it. I didn't say it this morning, but I have said it. And proven character, hope, and confident assurance of eternal salvation. Such hope in God's promises never disappoints us, because God's love has been abundantly poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. And so that's what our response should be. In the midst of trials and tribulations. God, see, that's the thing. God does not want to leave you in the wilderness. He wants to draw you out of that. But the road out of the wilderness is through His presence. Let that sink in. If you're like me, you want the shortcut. You're impatient. You're immature. Like me. You want the shortcut. Do I really got to go into God's presence to get past this obstacle? I don't know. Why don't we ask the children of Israel, who spent 40 years in the desert, in the wilderness, because they would not get to a place in their lives where they desired the presence of God. They wanted the promised land. So sometimes our response to all of that is, God, I need to hear from you. And so I used to pray this almost every time that we pray. I almost even prayed it this morning. I used to pray, God, draw me near to you. God, draw us near to you. And I want us to be clear about this concept this morning. Because there's a passage of scripture in John chapter 6, verse 44. It says this: no one can come to me, this was Jesus, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And so a lot of time we use that as a crutch to say, God, draw us to you. God, I don't hear you. God, draw us to you. God, I'm going through some trouble. God, draw us to you. I need to hear from you. And we get desperate. We want to hear from God. But how desperate do we really get? Sometimes you hear people say, well, have you prayed about it? And you're like, well, has it come to that? Has it? I mean, do we got to pray about it? Let me read all this before I get sidetracked, which happens occasionally. John 6:44, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. This scripture is talking about the unbeliever for salvation. It is not talking about the believer. The believer has already been redeemed. The redeemed has already been redeemed. The believer has already been redeemed. They've already been called out by God into relationship. You have already been called out by God into relationship. If you want to get close to God, you don't have to beg to be close to God. Well, you say, well, what do you mean, Pastor Clay? I've been in the wilderness and I can't hear God's voice. This is going to be a tough pill to swallow also. Your level of intimacy with God, with Jesus, with the Holy Spirit, and I want you to hear this. I want everybody's attention in this place. Your level of intimacy with the Holy Spirit is dependent upon you. If you tell me you haven't heard God, you haven't heard God's voice, it is only our fault. What does the Bible say about this? So what does the Bible say about intimacy with God? James chapter 4, verse 7 through 8 says, therefore, submit to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. And this is where the intimacy comes in. Draw near to God, and he might draw near to you if you've been good enough. No, that's not what the scripture says. It says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. So if you're saying, God, I can't hear your voice, when's the last time you draw near to God? When's the last time you open up your Bible and researched what you're going through? When's the last time you prayed about it? When's the last time you just worshiped him because that's all you could do? And we sit back and say, God, where you at? I can't see you, feel you, experience you, or anything. But it's in our hands. God says, you're redeemed. You're redeemed. Now pick it up and draw into his presence. Jeremiah 20. For us. And everybody wants to know that God has purpose and a plan for our life, right? Everybody loves a good business plan, right? Let me see your business plan. God's business model, his business plan is that he wants to bless you. That's great news. His business plan is that he wants to take you to the promised land. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everybody's excited about that. And they're like, no, Pastor Clay, we know you're setting a trap for us. Jeremiah 29:10 says, for thus says the Lord. And this was talking about God's chosen people, Israel. But we can apply this concept and principle to our lives to this day. Because we have been grafted into the vine. After 70 years are completed at Babylon, and this was talking about the Israelites being in captivity for 70 years, said, I will visit you and perform my good word towards you. So after you're in bondage, after you're in the wilderness, this was a different time of being in the wilderness than when they were in the actual wilderness. He says, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you and cause you to return to this place. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you. Do you believe, church, that God wants good for you? See, a lot of times we don't believe that God wants good for us because we look at ourselves and we realize how filthy and sinful and crooked and all those things, we realize those things about ourselves. Like nobody knows you as much as you know you. And so we look at God and think, well, if I know how I am, then surely God must know how I am. But guess what? If you're redeemed, if you're a believer, if you love Jesus, if you've confessed him as your Lord and Savior, and you shun sin, then when God looks at you, he sees you through the blood of Jesus. And he sees no fault in you. And I know that that's a hard concept to understand and wrap your head around. So how could God want a hope and a future for me? For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and listen. Listen to this. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me. God, where are you? God, why me? God, I can't hear your voice, but you will seek me and you will find me. When? When you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, says the Lord, and I will be found by you, says the Lord. When you seek him, he will be found by you. Your level of intimacy with God, with the Holy Spirit, with Jesus, depends on you seeking him. I will be found by you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations, from all the places where I've driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you to the place from which I caused you to be carried away captive. We're going to go to Hebrews chapter 4, verse 14, also talking about our intimacy with the Holy Spirit. Seeing that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast in our confession. Let us hold fast in our confession. Don't lose hope. Don't lose faith. Don't get frustrated by the wilderness. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. If you're in the wilderness and you are in need, all these passages of scriptures line up and point to one thing. That we need to pursue God, and we need to be serious about pursuing God. And we don't need to get into the wilderness and say, God, why me? And try to apply blame somewhere else when we can take a look in the mirror and say, what do I need to do to draw near to God? God is there. God is already there. He's already willing. He already wants to intercede. All he is waiting on is us to pursue him. So if we're found in the wilderness, there is a way out. There is a road map. There is actually a shortcut. It's called Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I got one good hallelujah out of that. I'm going to ask the worship team to come back at this time. And I'm not making light of the fact that we go through hardships and trials and tribulations. I realize that. I believe that God has mercy and grace on that. Go ahead. I believe that God has mercy and grace on us because of that. He realizes that we are going to get into a place of the wilderness and maybe lose our way. It happened to the children of Israel. It can happen to us so easily. But he does not want to leave you there. And he has given instruction over and over and over and over again to find the way out of the wilderness. But it is dependent on us. And we have to be a people that takes responsibility for our actions and says, you know what? I haven't pursued you, God, like I need to. I haven't cracked my Bible in a week. I haven't prayed in a month. But I stand here and say, God, where are you? And God, I confess that it's not your fault. We have to come to that realization that our intimate relationship with the Father is not by accident. It is very much intentional. And it depends on us pursuing Him. Glory to God. I mean, that should be good news to any believer. You mean all I got to do is pursue Him and He's going to work in my life? Yes. Yes, He will lead you. He will guide you. He will teach you. He will instruct you. I love this. I wasn't going to share this. But Jesus told His disciples, He said, it's better for you that I go away. And so His disciples are like, what are you talking about, Jesus? So if it's better for us, we can apply those words to us. If it's better for us that Jesus went away, why? So the Holy Spirit would come. The very Spirit of God would come to this earth and give us access to God. See, if it would have been better for Jesus to say, stay, if we wanted to go see Jesus, we'd most likely have to travel to Jerusalem, right? We'd have to book an airline. We'd have to get a bus ticket. We'd have to get, well, we're not taking a bus across the ocean, but we'd have to get to Jesus. And there'd be a line of hundreds of thousands of people waiting to get into the presence of Jesus, right? And Jesus says, no, 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 no. It's better that I go away and that the Holy Spirit, the one that can meet you face to face, one on one, in every situation of your life, He will be there for you. And all you have to do is draw near to Him and He will draw near to you. Amen. That's why the Holy Spirit is so important. Because it's about intimacy with Him, church. Let's rise to our feet. Let's bow our heads. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. God, thank you for teaching us this morning, putting a realization in our hearts, God, that we can come to you and serve you, that you have the answer, that you have provided the answer, you have provided the roadmap, you have provided the shortcut to get to where you want to take us, God. We seek you not for the purpose of the promised land, but we seek you because you are the promiser. God, we want to know you more. God, we pray that we would have willing hearts to seek after you and know who you are. And we pray that you would be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen.
hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good
is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Was born. treasure you found.
Love the presence of the Lord, church. There's nothing wrong at all with soaking in the presence of the Lord. There's no greater place to be.
Search me through and
God. We're going to pray and dismiss. And if there's anybody else that wants prayer, maybe you didn't feel comfortable coming up at the end of service, but we're going to linger here in this place, and you can be dismissed and be respectful of the ministry that's going on. But if any else needs prayer, we're here to lift you up in the name of Jesus. And we want to do that for you. So let's bow our heads. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus. We praise you and thank you for your goodness and faithfulness, God. Thank you for what you've done in this place and what you're going to do, God. Our hearts are expectant of your presence in the future. God, we love you and we thank you. Pray that you bless everyone here, that you'd go with them as they go home, God, and that this attitude of worship and pursuing you would continue throughout the weeks ahead, God. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.